Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Oh my goodness, aren't we blessed? Good morning, good morning, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Buffalo. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all of you who are mothers and all of you who have ever had a mother, biological, chosen, in-law, step. Happy Mother's Day to all of those mothers. It is so good to be with you again this morning. My goodness, I'm so lucky. My name is Joan Montagnes, and I have the honor and the privilege of serving you, this congregation, as minister. Welcome. We're in a Zoom worship service, a webinar, and that means that we can't hear or see you. You can't hear or see each other. But you can hear and see our worship associate, Fran Manley, and you can hear and see me. You can also chat with each other. You'll also be able to see some of our musicians today, Ben Havey, and also Jesse Downs and Jonathan Vogtel. Very exciting. You can also chat with each other all the way through the service. As you can see, you already are. And that's wonderful. We offer closed captioning that should be popping up along the bottom of your screen. If the captions help you, wonderful. If you want the font larger, please use the CC button and you can increase the font. And you can also turn the closed captions off if you find them distracting. I want to offer a big shout out to Josh Disick, John Petroselli, who was our tech today, Justin DeClean, Karen Streich, and all our music staff who help create our worship service every single week. Special shout out to Ben Havey, who's our special guest star today, noting that he is a person who grew up through our church school. That's already been noted in the chat. And now he's running off to the University of Missouri to earn himself, not that he needs to do much earning at this point, it seems, a doctor in musical arts, in music arts. Wow, so exciting. I have a few announcements here. First of all, General Assembly registration is open and we're looking for delegates. If you would like to be a delegate, please let me know. General Assembly is online this year. It's going to be seriously easy to access. They've got so good about that. And scholarship funds are available for the registration fee if you're interested in that. Just let me know. Memorial Day Sunday. We want to celebrate the lives of your beloved dead in a slideshow. If you would like to include a photo of your loved ones in our worship service that day, please send an electronic photo and the name of your loved one to Karen Streich by May 25th, and we'll be able to display the beautiful faces of your loved ones in our service. I will be leading a relational covenant workshop on May 29th from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Now, we had a first draft of our relational covenant, and y'all gave us feedback in all kinds of different ways. We've listened to that feedback. We took it very seriously. We've changed it up. We're taking a whole different tack on it, and we're going to present something else to you on May 29th, and it's a whole church event. We'd love it if you could be there. Be really nice to have as much of the congregation in that second draft redo as possible. And your participation in this process is vital. The Zoom for that is in the e-blast, the newsletter, and hopefully in the chat. Also, Vesper services, always, I just want to remind you, always outside the garden entrance every Friday night. Come for community music, candlelight, poetry, and meditation. This week, the music will be brought to you by Bruce Pfeffer, who will be playing the piano. It will be wonderful. So y'all come. And then after this service and after every worship service, we have a Zoom fellowship time. And the address for that Zoom fellowship time, when you can hear and see each other and talk to each other, will be in the chat, in the e-blast, in the newsletter, and on the last slide of this worship service. That is enough announcing. Come, let us worship.
Good morning. The poet William E. Stafford writes, "If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, a pattern that others made may prevail in the world, and following the wrong God home, we may miss our star. May this be a sacred hour, a time to nurture compassion and courage, a time to face our whole selves honestly, a time to learn how to know each other and how to love one another fervently. Come, let us worship."
In the Unitarian Universalist faith, we light a chalice, sign and symbol of our hope, heritage, and transforming love. So if you would like to join me in lighting your home chalice, let's see if I can get this lit. Isn't this just always the case? There we go. We can light, say our chalice lighting affirmation together. We gather in loving community to inspiring one another to transform ourselves to create a more just and compassionate world. Let's join in singing, "This is my song." Once upon a time, near the end of autumn, there was a bear who was getting very sleepy. But first, before he could settle down for a long winter's nap, Bear had a story to tell.
With a yawn, he asked Mouse, Would you like to hear a story?
I'm sorry, Bear, said Mouse, but it's almost winter and I have seeds to gather. Bear helped Mouse find seeds on the forest floor. When they had finished, Mouse said, "See you soon," and tunneled underground to wait for spring. Bear took slow, sleepy steps through the forest. Fallen leaves crunched under his feet. Bear sat down on a log to rest his tired legs, and along came Duck.
"Hello, Duck. Would you like to hear a story?"
"Wah, wah. I'm sorry, Bear, but it's almost winter, and I'm getting ready to fly south."
"I will miss you, Duck," said Bear.
And he raised a paw to check the direction of the wind.
"Quack, I'll miss you too," said Duck,
and off he flew. The sun was heavy and hung low in the sky. Bear's eyelids were getting heavy too. He counted the colors to stay awake.
3 pink clouds, 2 red leaves, 1 brown toad. "Hello, Toad. Would you like to hear a story?"
"Rabbit. I'm sorry, Bear," said Toad, "but it's almost winter, and I have to find a warm place to sleep."
Bear dug a toad-sized hole between 2 evergreens. Then he tucked Toad under a blanket of leaves and pine needles.
"Thank you, Bear, Rabbit. I'll see you in the spring."
Bear leaned against the old oak tree. He stretched and yawned again and scratched at his belly.
"I wonder if Mole's awake," he thought. "Mole? Are you there, Mole?"
But Mole was already asleep.
"Oh, good night, Mole."
The first winter snowflakes began to fall. Bear went into his den and fell fast asleep. Many months passed, and the sun returned. It melted the snow and woke the trees. Bear rolled onto the green grass.
"It's spring! Now I can tell my story."
But first Bear brought Mouse an acorn. "Thank you, Bear," said Mouse, who was very hungry after a long winter.
"Welcome home, Duck,"
called Bear.
"You must be tired from your journey."
Bear showed Duck a shady pond he'd found. Bear placed Toad in the sunshine till he was warm and awake. Toad opened one eye and then the other.
"Good morning,"
Bear said gently. Bear, Mouse, Duck, and Toad waited all day for Mole to wake up. Finally, Mole poked her nose into the moonlight.
"Mole," said Bear, "would you like to hear a story?"
Bear gathered all his friends around him. He sat up straight, cleared his throat, and puffed out his chest. With all his friends listening, Bear could not remember his story.
"Oh, it was such a good story. Now I've forgotten it. Winter is a very long time for a bear to remember anything."
The friends sat together for a long, quiet time. Then Mouse said, maybe your story is about a bear. And Duck said,
wah.
Maybe your story is about a busy time before winter.
Rabbit, I think there should be other characters in your story too, said Toad.
Like a mole, said Mole, and a mouse, and a duck, and a toad.
Now I remember.
Bear sat up straight again. He cleared his throat, puffed out his chest, and began his story.
Once upon a time, near the end of autumn, there was a bear who was getting very sleepy.
Every week, we take a good portion of our Sunday morning offering and give it away to a social justice cause outside our church walls. This month, we're supporting the good work of Literacy Buffalo Niagara. Literacy Buffalo Niagara helps our community with literacy skills by providing free tutoring in Erie and Niagara counties. You can use PayPal by going to our website, www.buffalouu.org, and clicking on the blue donate button. Or you can send a check by mail to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Buffalo, 695 Elmwood Avenue, Buffalo, New York, 14222. You can also arrange a regular automatic deposit with your bank. If yours is a gift to our Share the Plate ministry, please write share on the memo line, and it will be shared between Literacy Buffalo Niagara and the church operating budget. If yours is a welcome gift to our congregation, please write Pledge 2021 on the memo line. Either way, please write UUCB on the important line and we will do the bookkeeping. Your generosity can begin to tell the story we've all been hoping to hear.
Oh,
reading this morning is called The Danger of a Single Story. It's an excerpt from a TED Talk by Chinamanda Ngozi Adichie. If you like this little piece, you might like to listen to the whole talk, and there you will find a link to it in the chat. A few years ago, I visited Mexico from the U.S. The political climate in the U.S. at the time was tense, and there were debates going on about immigration. And as often happens in America, immigration became synonymous with Mexicans. There were endless stories of Mexicans as people who were fleecing the healthcare system, sneaking across the border, being arrested at the border, that sort of thing. I remember walking around on my first day in Guadalajara, watching the people going to work, rolling up tortillas in the marketplace, smoking, laughing. I remember first feeling slight surprise, and then I was overwhelmed with shame. I realized that I had been so immersed in the media coverage of Mexicans that they had become one thing in my mind, the abject immigrant. I had bought into the single story of Mexicans, and I could not have been more ashamed of myself. So that is how we kind of create a single story, show a people as one thing, as only one thing, over and over again, and that is what they become. It is impossible to talk about the single story without talking about power. There is a word, an Igbo word, that I think about whenever I think about the power structures of the world, and it is Inkali. It's a noun that loosely translates to be greater than another. Like our economic and political worlds, stories too are defined by the principle of Inkali. How they are told, who tells them, when they're told, how many stories are told, are really dependent on power. Power is the ability not just to tell the story of another person, but to make it the definitive story of that person.
Let's join our hearts and minds together in a quiet moment of prayer, reflection, and meditation. May we become a people who share stories. Narratives that wander over time and place through lives lost and rediscovered, broken and transformed. May we be a people who listen beyond the patterns that others make. May we listen beyond the patterns of power and stereotype. Beyond expectations, assumptions, and pre-arrangements, beyond us and them, either or. May we begin to listen to the truths each has to tell, huge truths, great, delicious, excruciating sagas, multi-dimensional, complex stories, all waiting to be shared, full of abundance and yes, and more. Let us hold a soft nest of a community lined with warm down to cradle hearts and lives offered timorously, courageously into our keeping. And let us slowly, with patience and self-care, tell our stories so we will know what kind of people we are and find together we can follow our star home. Today, we're especially holding in our hearts Kate Silver, who celebrated a birthday this week. Good to have you in our lives. We also offer condolences to Andrea Burke Harris and her family. Andrea's mother passed away this week. And our hearts are with Arlene Miles and all the friends and loved ones of John Segman. John passed away on Thursday. And now let us open our worship space to the names of all our loved ones suffering in sorrow and celebrating in joy, each name a breath, each breath a prayer.
Thank you.
The breath of nature is upon us. The spirit of life is within us. The community of love is among us. So be it. Blessed be. And let the church say, Amen. And now I would like to make a public service announcement. There was a mathematical error in last week's sermon. In my address, I spoke of the Pythagorean theory, when in fact the mathematical formula is the Pythagorean theorem, which, if you speak to any mathematician, is a whole different ballgame. And let me tell you, mathematicians have been speaking to me. I take full responsibility for any misunderstanding or inconvenience my error may have caused. Pastoral hours will be set aside to respond to all calls and emails should you need extra care after this distortion of reality. Speaking of distortions in reality, here's a story people tell about me. Perhaps I help people tell it. It's a true story, a singular story that is much more interesting than the story of most of my working life. After all, the story includes polar bears, meeting my husband, hiking in the midnight sun, and being the world expert on a rare Arctic moss. But this story that has been told about me, this story is not a full story of who I am. Now, some of you think that I'm a real live scientist who actually knows things about mathematical formulas and the like. And maybe only later in life, maybe as a second career or on a whim even, I took up the mantle of ministry. That story is not quite true or whole. Yes, I went to school for biology, but I spent an equal number of years training to be a minister. I had several short part-time jobs in labs and as a field biologist, but I have been a minister for almost 28 years. So these days, when I think of my identity, my truth, my story, I don't really think of myself as a scientist. That's my confession to you this morning. And I really hope you don't think less of me. Telling your story, your whole truth. Well, that takes courage. Sometimes you have to be a little vulnerable in the telling, a little naked. And that can feel dangerous. But I'll tell you, it's much more dangerous if there is only one story that defines you. So when I think of all of my identities, all the little bits of truth that make up my story now, if I think about it now, at this moment, off the top of my head, I might say, female, white, wife, Unitarian Universalist minister, resident alien, privileged, daughter, cat lover, sister, educated, storyteller, able-bodied, aspiring foodie, homeowner. That'll do. I mean, these are just a few things that come to mind about who I am. If you were going to share some of your identities, some of your truths, some of your story, what would those identities be? Let's make this kind of an interactive portion of the service. What would your identities be? Feel free to put them in the chat there, and we'll just read through them as we'll do in this sermon here. So just type in a few identities that you would feel comfortable claiming in this space. And I don't think I'm seeing any come up now, but I'm sure you're all typing madly. There we go, an educator. Thank you. Aging white female, black mother. You can read them. I'm gonna, mother, organizer, survivor, keep them coming because we can multitask here. Every one of your identities is part of that dynamic, growing, exciting multi-universe that is you. And every part of you tells part of your whole story. Now, it is easy enough to tell a single unidimensional static story. Especially, it's easy to tell a single story about someone else or even a whole group of people. Tell a story that describes a person or a people as one thing, as only one thing, over and over and over again, and that is what they become. It's what we often call a stereotype, right? And what we're really playing with when we tell a single story, what we're really playing with here is power. We use our power not only to tell the story of another person, but also to make it the definitive story of that person. And we also use the story to define our power, right? I'm going to tell a story, and that helps me define my power in relationship to you. Example. In my family, we had great Aunt Grace, poor old great Aunt Grace. The story we told about great Aunt Grace was that she was mad as a hatter. She wanted to pull her brains out of her nose. That was the story. And so the family tucked her away in a back room of the attic. And so she was never seen or heard when polite company came to call. Very gothic. Well, one day when my mom was a rebellious teenager, she decided to sneak up to the attic and have a look at this real live family crazy person. Well, there was great Aunt Grace. They got to talking, and it turns out great Aunt Grace was a pretty interesting woman. She had tales to tell, books to recommend. She had opinions about art, songs to sing, and she cussed like a sailor. Aunt Grace had spent her wild youth careening through Europe, drinking, smoking, listening to jazz, falling into the arms of multiple lovers, and swimming in the azure waters of the Mediterranean. Until the family sent a representative out to bring her home. And when she protested, the family sent her to a psychiatrist and stuck her in the attic. So Mom took to visiting great Aunt Grace quite a bit. They built a close, deep, and loving friendship. And guess what? Turns out great Aunt Grace didn't really like the rest of the family too much and was pretty happy to stay in the attic when polite company came to call. But the greater truth was she had lost her wholeness and was a medicated shell of what she had once been. My family used their collective power to tell a single story over and over again. They told a story about a person, and that whole person became tiny and narrow to the whole world. She literally was physically, mentally, and spiritually trapped in the power of their story. So you see, there may be a danger to telling your story, your truth, It's sometimes hard to reveal yourself to the world, but there's a greater danger in not telling your story, in not being able to tell your story. An even greater danger exists if we don't set aside the sacred time. Amid all our phenomenally busy lives, there's a greater danger still if we do not set aside a sacred time to listen to one another. In fact, our busyness is another single story we tell about ourselves. And that story has power over us, right? What if we stop telling that false narrative about being too busy for each other? I mean, what if we did that? Radical. Whoa. If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, a pattern that others made may prevail in the world. And following the wrong God home, we may miss our star. If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, someone else is going to tell our stories, or we may start telling stories about each other. And those single stories are laced with dangerous power differentials. If you don't know this kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, if we don't set aside the sacred time to listen to one another, to hear the stories we have to tell, the moment will be lost, forgotten. And you may have to start at the beginning again, never deepening relationship. If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, we're going to get lost on the way to beloved community. We will miss our star. One more story. Some years ago, I was talking to this guy in the congregation, a congregation far, far away in a galaxy a long time ago. And he was lamenting his aloneness in the congregation. He said, "I am the only working class Texan man here caring for his mother. I can't figure out where I fit into this congregation." I sat with him in his sadness for quite a while. And then I opened the space. I can understand how that feels, very lonely. And I know something. You are not alone. Our congregation is full of men, some of whom identify as working class, and many of us are caring for aging parents. Maybe together, you and I can find some friends who might understand some of your experience. And I know something else. You are much more than a working class Texan who cares for his mother. You are all of that, and it's important. And a drum player, a football fan, you have a telescope and know all kinds of things about the stars. You make beer, you read science fiction, and you have a really, really big heart. And that's just a few things I know about you. And I know something else too. There's a universe of beauty inside of you, a river flowing in your soul. So much, I have no idea about. I would love to hear more about your story. Let's join in singing. There's a river flowing in my soul.
There's a river flowing in my soul.
In my soul.
Please join me now in our words for extinguishing the flame of our chalice. As we extinguish the flame of this chalice, may we carry its light with us into the world in the power of peace, faith, justice, and love.
As we listen to one another in tender trust, descending deeper into longings and learnings, hopes and fears. Remember you are blessed. Remember you are a blessing. And above all else, remember you are not alone. You are never alone. So be it. Blessed be. And let the church say, Amen.
Oh,
pressure.